So the talk will be delivered by Sheikh Khadi Lutfur Rahman. So just to introduce you to him, he's the director of ADP Al-Falaq Dawah Project. He has memorized the Quran from an early age, the whole Quran. He is currently the Imam and Khatib at London Central Mosque, also known as Midland Park Mosque. He was the ex-Imam of Stephanie Sajjah Masjid. He regularly delivers lectures and talks in Midland Park Masjid, both in English and Arabic language. He has graduated in Al-Azhar from Al-Azhar University in Cairo.
السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا على نعمه الاسلام. فهذه النعمه العظيمه التي انقذنا الله بها من الظلمات الى النور ومن علينا بها بخير خلقه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم يا مفتح الابواب يا مسبب الاسباب ويا دليل الحائرين عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير. ثم ما بعد, distinguished honorable scholars, respected imams, and my beloved brothers and sisters. First of all, I'd like to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the ability to come and join and gather in this very blessed masjid, known as Badr State Masjid in Taha Masjid, London. We are fortunate and privileged to be in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after performing Salat al-Isha in congregation. I also would like to thank the Masjid Management Committee for allowing us to hold this program, auspicious program, in their masjid. Barakallahu feehim. I was actually really enjoying, I don't think I can speak much because I was enjoying too much before, especially the recitation of the Quran al-Kareem by our young brother Al-Qari Abdullah Al-Madani, the son of our beloved Shaykh, Fadilat Shaykh Abdul Rahman Al-Madani, Hafidhahullah, is also here with us. We are happy to have him. MashaAllah, it's a very soothing recitation. May Allah continue to increase that ni'mah. Him, and also Brother Masoom, mashallah, I really love him. He's local but international. He's local yet he's international because mashallah he goes outside UK, abroad, and he also performs masjids all over the world. It is the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Allah the Almighty. May Allah increase and bless the projects. Now, the topic that I was really interested to talk tonight for a few moments is the noble Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the hero. Why did I choose this topic? I would like our brothers to actually share their thoughts, and also I want to know what you think. Why do you think that I was interested to choose the topic Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the hero? Because there can be many other titles. We can say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a messenger of Allah, a Nabi of Allah, a prophet of Allah, a great individual. We can say all of those things. But why do we say he is a hero? Because as human beings, we have heroes in our life. Some of us, we have heroes, the football players. We choose some celebrities as our heroes. So for some of us, some of the football players can be hero. And then for other people, it could be some singers, songwriters, singers. For others, it could be an actors. For some people, it could be a political leader, a hero. Or for some people, it could be a dynamic orator, a speaker. So every one of us, we have some heroes in our life. But who is the actual hero of the heroes? That we need to find out tonight. And as for Muslims, I know there is no difference of opinions among ourselves as Muslims about the greatness of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is there any difference of opinions? Is there any Muslim where you can find, is there any Muslim who doesn't appreciate and acknowledge the greatness of the last messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? I don't think so. I don't think we have any difference of opinions. We all accept him as Sayyid al-Mursaleen, the leader of all the messengers and prophets. Sayyid al-Kalnayn, master of the both worlds, dunya and akhirah, this one and the next one. Sayyid al-Kalnayn, Sayyid Walad Adam, the master of the children of Adam, Bani Adam. We all accept these things. Sayyid Walad Adam. There is no any doubt. There is no difference of opinions amongst Muslims. So how do we deal with this topic? Now, to understand the greatness of an individual, you have to see what the oppositions, what the oppositions are saying, or people in the opposite camps. What are they saying? What are they thinking about an individual? And that's how we can understand the greatness of a person. Obviously, the lovers, the followers, the disciples, we praise, we speak good, we say good things about their hero, about their beloved. But the greatness of a man, of an individual, appears and it's proven when we see the good comments are coming from the opposite camps, from the camps of non-Muslims. When they are speaking good about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we can really appreciate and understand how this man Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. So let's look at some of the statements which were given and expressed by some of the great non-Muslim writers, thinkers, and intellectuals. First of all, let's talk about a man by the name of Thomas Carlyle, and he was a Scottish philosopher, historian, and he gave a series of lectures around 1840, titled as On Heroes and Hero Worship. What's his name? Thomas Carlyle, a Scottish philosopher and historian. And he gave a series of lectures on heroes of this world and hero worship. And he selected, Thomas Carlyle selected Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace be upon him, to be his example of a prophet as a hero. Subhanallah. A non-Muslim, a philosopher, a historian from Scotland, in 1840. And he selected Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be as a hero prophet. And his discourse has been wonderful. And he speaks very well and highly when he said, a great change. He said, a great change in the world, in the history of humanity. And we all know how the Arabs were before actually Islam, before the arrival of Islam and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how the Arabs were the worst nation that you can ever find on the face of the earth. The people, they commit incest, they commit, they kill and murder their girls alive. They do the worst things in the world. They gamble, they do the worst thing, they fight for years and years, for decades over petty things. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came in that nation. And of course, you know, in terms of the aqidah, in terms of the belief, they are pagans. They used to believe, they used to worship idols. So he says, Thomas Carlyle says, a great change. What change and progress is indicated here? In the universal condition and thoughts of man. So people used to believe, people used to believe in the shirk. They used to associate part of Allah. The hero is now regarded as a god among his fellow men, but as one with his planet. It's not now. The hero is not, because back in the days, anybody who is great, they will say he's a god. People start worshiping. Lord. You know, you see even English people, they say when they find someone really amazing, they start calling him Lord. Lord this, Lord that. And so they have this nature of believing that people and human beings become God. So he says here, the hero is not now regarded as a god among his fellow men. They don't believe he's a god, but as one god inspired, as a prophet, it is the second phase of hero worship. the first or oldest, we may say, has passed away without return. In the history of the world, there will not be again be any man. There will be no man coming after in the history of human beings. Never so great whom his fellow man will take for a god. Nay, we might rationally ask, did any set of human beings ever really think the man they saw, the standing beside the god of this world? Perhaps not. It was usually some man they remembered or had seen, but neither can this be anymore. So that's Thomas Campbell. According to Britannica, I'm sure you all have heard of Britannica, the British Encyclopedia, it considers Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be the most important religious figures in the history of humanity. This is Britannica, the British Encyclopedia, talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Statements and the tributes are coming from the opposite side, and that's how we understand the greatness of an individual. And even before Prophet became a prophet, what was the title? What title was given? A son, the truthful, and Al-Wa'dil Amin, trustworthy, truthful. This kind of title were given to him before even he became a prophet. And of course, after he became a prophet, what the others are saying. So, according to Britannica, Muhammad is the most important religious figures in the history of mankind. You have heard of a man called Alphonse de Lamartine. Alphonse de Lamartine, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing the name correctly, but he's a French writer, a poet, and a politician who was instrumental in the foundation of the Second Republic of France. A very influential man in France, in the history of France. Known as Alphonse de Lamartine, died in 1869. He speaks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his famous book History of Turkey. He says about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Listen to this. He says, philosopher, right? A man of hikmah, wisdom, philosopher, orator, a beautiful speaker, khatib. Right, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Uthiya Jawami al-Kalim. He would speak less, but he was the most eloquent. His speech and his language attracted hundreds of thousands of people around him. His language, Jawami al-Kalim, he used to speak less, but it was very profound, very meaningful. And that was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, orator, that's Lamartine saying. And then he said, apostle, a blessed man, a messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Legislator, muqallim, musharrah, legislator, make the legislation. What did he do? How does he become a legislator? Many of us probably don't know the Prophet ﷺ had two major episodes in his life, the Meccan time and the time in Medina Munawwara. What did he do mostly in Mecca and Mukarramah? Please join me. I don't want to be too boring. So, what did Prophet ﷺ do? What did he do mostly in Mecca and Mukarramah? What was his activities in Mecca? Brother here, please speak and help me. What did he do the most? Obviously, after he became a prophet, invite people to Islam. But what aspect was he covering mainly? Yes, the oneness of Allah, Tawheed. He was calling people to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else did he do? He invited people to Islam. He told people to know the shirk and leave the idols and statues. Okay? He built the character, and even if you look at the Quran al-Kareem, you find the surah, the chapters that deal were revealed in Makkah and Mukarramah, deals mostly about the aqidah, the faith and creeds of Muslims. But when he entered and when he migrated to Medina al-Munawwara, what did he do? He established a society. He established a society in Medina al-Munawwara, and he conquered, obviously, Makkah and Mukarramah was conquered, and he became conqueror of many places. And Muslims became powerful and dominant nation in Medina Munawwara. So he was a legislator. Two major episodes in the life of Rasulullah, Meccan time and the time of Medina. Legislator, he makes laws, legislation, warrior. Of course, he participated in many battles. Conqueror of ideas. And then restorer of rational dogmas, the religious teachings. the store of rational dollars. Of a car without images, the founder of 20 terrestrial empires. Think about it. Founder of 20 terrestrial empires. This is Prophet Muhammad alayhi wasallam. And of one spiritual empire. Not only just empires, but the spiritual, the divine, godly empires. That is Muhammad, as regards all the standards by which human greatness may be measured, we may well ask, is there any man greater than he? That's a question. He finishes, concludes his statement by saying, is there any man greater than he, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Of course not. Definitely not. There's no other man greater than Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's Alphonse de Lamartine, a French writer, poet and politician, and he was an important individual in the Second Republic of France, and also he had a contribution towards the French flag in 1869. Talk about a man called by the name of Michael H. Hunt. I'm sure you've heard of his name. And he is the Michael H. Hunt of the Heart Plant Foundation in the United States of America. He speaks in 1932, professor of astronomy, physics, and history of science. Michael H. Hunt. He was interested to write a book and talking about some of the most influential men of history. In the history of humanity. He wanted to speak about some of the important people in the history of human beings. And he decided to write a book entitled as The 100, a ranking of the most influential persons in history. In New York, 1978, he writes his book, The 100, a ranking of the most influential persons in history. And he speaks about 100 important people in the history of human beings. You see, a scholar, a professor of astronomy, not a normal individual. And also, he is a Hunt Foundation famous in the United States of America. And he wants to speak about 100 most influential people. And guess what? He chose Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be top on the list. The first man that ever spoke is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody else. Not even his savior, Jesus, his Lord, Savior. Jesus, not even Jesus, peace be upon him. He never chose being a Christian. Individual never chose Jesus, his savior, obviously, the savior and Lord. Jesus wasn't the first man in the list of Michael H. Hunt, but he speaks about Muhammad and he placed Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam right at the top. And Jesus, peace be upon him, Isa alaihi wasallam, was third in his list. And so he says in his book, Michael H. Hunt, my choice of Muhammad to lead the list of the world's most influential persons. May surprise some readers. It may surprise because people obviously will say, you know, you're a Christian, you know, naturally and by default you should be talking about Isa alayhi salam. So he says, may surprise some readers and maybe questioned by others. And maybe questioned by others. Why am I talking about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? It's a time when you know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the most bombarded and attacked individual from the enemies of Islam. And you see, in our modern time, in the last probably 100 years or more than 100 years, approximately, if I'm not wrong, that approximately 500 books were written against Islam. 500 books were written directly and indirectly against Islam. And some people say, oh, Islam, you know, Muslims, they're extremists, they're fanatics, they're fundamentalists. Talk about other people, they talk about, they attack other religions, but to speak the truth, the Muslims, against Muslims were approximately 500 books were written in our recent time against Islam. So, at a time, the Michael H. Hunt is saying, but some, it may surprise some readers and may be questioned by others, but he was the only man in history who was supremely successful on both the religious and the secular level. On religious as well as secular level, meaning he was a religious successful person, but also in the worldly matters, he was also a successful person on secular level. Now, we'd like to obviously speak to our non-Muslim brothers and sisters and say that take an account on that. Take an account on that in the statements of Michael H. how he is speaking about the noble Prophet Muhammad, Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we have people like William Montgomery Watt, professor of Arabic and Islamic studies at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland, in 1909, professor of Arabic and Islamic studies in the University of Edinburgh, Professor William is saying his readiness to undergo persecutions for his beliefs. I mean, he was persecuted by his enemies the most people we could ever think. He was driven out from his house, from his homeland, Mecca, here to migrate, here to go Medina. His sacrifice is so great. We are actually benefiting from the sacrifice of the Prophet up until today. It is his sacrifice, and therefore we can claim to be or to be a possessor of a very clear and very plain faith that monotheism, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because of these reasons, the non-Muslims are attracted. Do you know why the non-Muslims are attracted? Because when they look at the faith of Muslim, there's no ambiguity, there's no confusion, there's no there's no any confusion at all in the faith of the Muslim. They always say there's none worthy of worship except one Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. That's the most clear, that's the most plain faith ever you can find. So there's no ambiguity in it. So he was persecuted, persecution was for his beliefs. The high moral character of the man, no Muslim speaking, high moral character of the man who believed in him and looked up to him as leader, and the greatness of his ultimate achievement, all argue his fundamental integrity. To suppose Muhammad an imposter raised more problems than it solves. So if someone says Muhammad is an imposter, it raised more problems than it solved. Moreover, none of the great figures of history is so poorly appreciated in the West as Muhammad. So none of the great figures of history is so poorly appreciated in the West as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He speaks in his book, Muhammad al-Makkah, published in Oxford, 1953. And then you've got, let's come to our country's limit, to subcontinent, Asian subcontinent. We've got a man by the name of Mahatma Gandhi. Have you heard of his name? Mahatma Gandhi, a famous Indian philosopher, writer, Indian thinker, a statesman, and also a national leader, Mahatma Gandhi. And he wrote many, many books, you all know these things. And he said in a statement, speaking and giving tribute to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by saying, I became more than ever convinced that it was not the sword that won a place of Islam in those days in the scheme of life. As many people, one of the biggest claim and accusation against Islam by the enemies of Islam is Islam was forced upon people. Islam was spread under the force of gun. That's what many people and enemies of Islam, states and non-Muslims, enemies of Islam, they spread this accusation and allegation against Islam. One of them is Islam was spread through the sword. And another one, Muslims oppress the women. This is another one. These are very common. So here we have Mahatma Gandhi saying that I became more than ever convinced that it was not the sword that won the place of Islam in those days in the scheme of life. So it wasn't really the sword. If it was so, then we still see India, which was ruled by the Mughals. Do you know how many years the Mughals ruled? And the Muslim rulers ruled India for 1,000 years. Mughals, known as Mughals, for 1,000 years. And in the partition, we see 90% remains Hindus and 10% only Muslims. If Islam was forced upon non-Muslims, then the Mughals would definitely force Islam upon the Hindus, but that didn't happen. Take examples of 9 million non-Muslims that still reside in the Middle East, and they're Coptic Christians. Coptic Christian means they were Christians before Islam. They were Christians before Islam. If the Muslims ever forced anybody to become Muslim, then there would be no non-Muslim Christians or Jews or Hindus in the Middle East that have Islam. But that wasn't the case. We still find that 10-15% Egyptians are Christians, 20% Lebanese Christians. There are Christians all over the Arab world. So Muslims are forced, and that doesn't make sense. If it was the case, then you know, Spain was ruled by the non-Muslims, Muslims for how many years? Approximately, how many years? Spain? 800 years, Spain was ruled by Muslims. But in the day, on the day the Muslims were defeated, there was not a man to prevent Azan. So that shows, of course, on one side, the Muslims didn't do their jobs, the job of da'wah, you know. They didn't take the responsibility of da'wah Allah, calling people to the path of Allah. But on the other hand, we also understand that Islam was enforced upon the Spanish people. Otherwise, we'd find many Spanish people Muslims. But that wasn't the case. So Islam wasn't really enforced upon people. It was the rigid. Then he says, it was the rigid simplicity. Simple. There's a saying that ultimate sophistication is in simplicity. The more professional you become, the more simple you become in life. And that's the sign of professionalism. So he said it was the rigid simplicity, the utter self-effacement of the Prophet, the scrupulous regard for his pleasures, his intense devotion to his friends and followers. So he was devoted for his Sahaba, but they were. And there is a saying, if you really want to know the greatness of a man also, then see and look at his students, the quality of the students he produces. So see the quality of the students that a person produces, and then you can see the greatness of the teacher, and see how Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was, how Umar ibn Khattab was, how Uthman ibn Affan was. These people, they shook the whole entire world. They ruled half of the world, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. So you can see the greatness of a teacher, you see the greatness of the students, the standard of the students. So Rasulullah produced a dynamic group of Sahaba, the most honorable people after the Messenger alayhi wasallam. So he was devoted to his friends and followers. His integrity, his fearlessness, his absolute trust in Allah, God, and his own mission. These and not the sword carrying everything before them and surmount every trouble. So this is again speaking in young India, 1938. So tributes are coming from the non-Muslim side, and that's how we understand the greatness of individual. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still find giving before, obviously, mentioning about the non-Muslim's statements? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us before everybody, before anybody and everybody. He said in the Quran, okay, Surah Al-Ahzab, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. Allah the Almighty says in Surah Al-Ahzab, لقد كان لكم in the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're the best example. Best example. You want a role model? You want somebody, you want to make someone a celebrity in your life? Then go back to the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most successful man in the history of human beings. Go back to him. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. In the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you'll find the best examples for everything. You want an example, a role model, as a husband, see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, خِيَارَكُمْ لِأَهْلِي خِيَارَكُمْ خِيَارَكُمْ لِأَهْلِي وَأَنَا خِيَارَكُمْ لِأَهْلِي. He said, the best one of you is the one who is best to his family. Yeah. Obviously, you can be the best man, the best looking person, or maybe the hero outside in front of other people. But to come as a certificate coming from the family, from your own family, is the best certificate they ever get. So he said, the best one of you is the one who's best to his family, and I am best to my family. Because Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha, when he spoke about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was asked about the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she answered by saying, كان خلقه القرآن. He was a living Quran. If you want to see Al-Quran Kareem as a live example, then see the life of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the Quran himself. His everything, his actions, his character, his conduct, his behavior, his dealing with transaction. So you want a role model as a husband, then see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want to see a role model as a leader, a political leader, then don't you have to go to the individuals here and there, like many of us, we make like some of people, heroes in our life, and leave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam aside. You know, it's a great mistake, and Muslims will never succeed. We will never be successful unless we adhere to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as our hero. Because Allah said in the Quran al-Kareem, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا اِسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُ أَمْثَالَكُمْ. That if you turn away, Allah doesn't need of us. He doesn't need us. We are in need of Allah. And he said, if you don't do your responsibility, after you've been granted as the best of nations, khayr ummah, right? Khayr ummah in Quran. After you've been granted a certificate, that status, rank, if you don't do your responsibilities, ta'amuna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar, enjoin what is right and forbid what is evil. If you don't do the job of amr bil ma'ruf wa nahya 'anil munkar, then Allah says, wa in tatawalla, you go away, if you turn away, istabdil qawman ghayrakum. Allah will bring people from outside. He will bring other people and he will displace and he will exchange you with other people. Okay? And he will put other people on his neck. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُمْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ. And they will be like you. They will not be like you. So Islam was served by many different people. You see, initially Islam began in the Arabian Peninsula, and soon Islam was served by Iraqi, Baghdad, Kufa and Basra, and soon it moved down to Persia. Most of the scholars of Hadith was from Fars, like Imam al-Bukhari, Tirmidhi, Imam al-Nasa'i. Most of the scholars of Hadith were actually non-Arabs and Persians. Many scholars of Arabic language were non-Arabs as well. Sibawayh and the great scholars of Arabic language were non-Arabs themselves. So Islam was served by many people outside the Arab world. So I'm going to say, if you ever leave my religion, then you'll be punished for sure. And also, Allah will bring other people and they will take the flower of Islam. Allah is not in any of you. When did Allah say that? Qawm ghayrakum, thumma la yakum amthalakum. So we are actually most in need of the teaching of Rasulullah. I just want to mention the teaching about, of course, is very great, and we can speak on and on, speak on this region, but I just want to mention two, three famous and beautiful teachings of our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. What he should offer for the humanity, what did he give us? So, of course, he taught the humanity about the disease of arrogance and pride that many of us we suffer from. We have the biggest disease by nature. We're all racist. We have racism, right? Bengali people don't like Pakistanis. Pakistani people don't like Bengalis. And then within Bengalis, you find hostility, non-hostility, hostility, and takayu. And then you go within Pakistani people, there's Punjab, there's Pathan, there's all this conflict. Within the Arab world, you have Egyptians, Saudi Arabian, Moroccan, Algerian, you've got all this conflict. So by nature, many of us, we are actually racist to certain degrees. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he doesn't love and he doesn't like arrogance and pride. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the first individual to stand before the humanity. And he calls upon mankind by saying, and he destroys and he fights and combats the disease of racism that we have in our minds and hearts. So he says, in a hadith according to Imam Abu Hurairah, Sayyidina Abu Hurairah, the Prophet said, Inna Allah Azza wa Jal qad adhaba ankum rubbiyyat al-jahiliyyah wa fakhra hadhihi al-abaa. That Allah the Almighty, he removed the disease of ignorance, jahiliyyah, the racism that was inherited from the jahiliyyah, the time of jahiliyyah. And then he said, فَخْرَهَا بِالْآبَاء. And also pride, arrogance because of fathers. You know, some people say, do you know who my father is? Do you know where I come from? Do you know who my parents are? So there are people who boast because of their parents. And that happens and still happens in this world. And then Prophet ﷺ continues and proceeds here. He says, أَنْتُمْ بَالْمُعَادَمْ. Every one of you children of Adam, or Adam and Torah. Check this, Adam and Torah. Well, how better it can explain that Adam was from dust, from clay, from dust. You are nothing, min Torah. And they say, لَا يَدْعَنَّ رِجَالٌ فَحْمٌ بِأَقْوَامٍ إِلَّمَا فَحْمٌ مِنْ فَيْلِ جَهَنَّمٍ أَوْ لَيَكُولَنْ أَقْوَحَ عَوَانٍ مِنْ الْجَعَانٍ. So Prophet he speaks very in details. He says, لَا فَقْدَ لِعَرْبِيٍّ عَلَى عَجَمِي. No superiority of Arabs over non-Arabs, and no superiority of non-Arabs over Arabs. No superiority of white over black, and no superiority of black over white. And then it's accept the God consciousness, accept how you are with Allah and with your fellow human beings, your behavior with Allah and your connection with Allah and your conduct with your fellow human beings. That what makes you a person, whether good or bad. So it again, he destroys the disease of pride, arrogance, and boasting about one's family, discrimination and racism amongst the human beings. He was sent, Prophet ﷺ was sent as a rahmah, as a mercy to the mankind. So Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that I have not sent you, O Muhammad, except as a mercy to the Muslims only? To Muslims only? No. To human beings only? No. لِلْعَالَمِينَ. To the universe, to all creation, not only to human beings, a mercy to the entire universe, لِلْعَالَمِينَ, عالم, universe, and more than that, world. So he was sent as a mercy to the entire world. And this Prophet of mercy, he said, Ar-Rahimun, Ya Arhamur Rahman. Those who are merciful, kind, tolerant in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes merciful with them. Ar-Rahman, the merciful God, becomes merciful with the people of mercy. Ar-Rahimun, Ya Arhamur Rahman. And it's Irhamu man fil ard. Be kind and be merciful to the one on this earth. Be kind and merciful. And check this, if you do it, and you can experience it. يَرْحَمُكُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ. And the one in the heaven will be kind and merciful to you. يَرْحَمُكُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ. And then, this is the teaching of Rasulullah SAW. And I want to mention, obviously you know how merciful he was with the Muslims, with the human beings. And he was respectful even to people of other faith. Do you know, there was a janazah, there was a funeral of a Yahudi, a Jewish man. Prophet SAW stood up in order to show his respect. Then a man came, as Sahaba said, we were shocked. They were like, how can you stand up for a Yahudi person, a non-Muslim, a Jewish man? So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, is he not a human being? And then he stood up and he showed his respect to the humanity. Because human being, this was Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You know, a lady, she used to clean the house of Allah, Masjid al-Nabawi, and she was a black girl. And one day Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he didn't see her. And he was asking about her. Sahaba didn't mention to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam because they kind of undermined her. Because she's like a cleaner and she's black. Now, you know, why do we have to tell Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? It's not important. So Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked, like, where is that girl? I can't see him anymore. I can't see her anymore. So they said that, you know, that she was, she passed away. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was really upset. And he said, why don't you tell me that, you know, she passed away? And she went to her grave and the janazah and he made dua for her. This was Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his character and his behavior. And then his behavior with the world of animals and birds. I want to mention one hadith, which I want to mention today. There's a hadith mentioned in the book of Abu Dawud, rahmatullah alayhi, Abdurrahman ibn Abdullah, an Abi, qala kunna ma'a Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This great companion, he said, we were with Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once on a journey, he suffered. فانطلق لحاجته. So, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he went a little bit far for something that he wanted to do, to do something. فَرَأَيْنَا حُمَّا مَعَهَا فَرْخَانَ. And then he said, we saw a bird with two child birds, two small birds, children. مَعَهَا فَرْخَانَ. فَأَخَذْنَا فَرْخَيْهَا فَجَعَتْ الْحُمَّا. And then the companions said, we were kind of like start to joke. We were teasing with the, we were playing with the birds. So we took one of the birds away. And then the mother bird, she came, her mother came, and she started to look and search for the baby bird. So جَعَلَتْ تُعَرِّشُ. And the mother bird started to look around, and the companions, they're just like hiding, just playing around. So Prophet then came, فَجَعَلَ نَبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالَ مَنْ فَجَعَ هَذِهِ بِوَالِدِهَا. Who done this? Who is playing around with this bird? Who is terrorizing? Who is terrifying this mother bird? Forget terrorizing human beings. Like birds, Prophet is saying, who is actually terrifying the mother bird? مَنْ فَجَعَ هَذَا بِوَلَدِهَا رُدُّ وَلَدَهَا إِلَيْهَا. And then he said, that give it instantly, give the baby bird to her mother. Instantly, رُدُّ وَلَدَهَا إِلَيْهَا. وَرَبَى قَرْيَةَ نَمْلٍ. And then they were, they still proceeded their journey. And then they saw a place, there was lots of like ants, what do you call the nest of ants? Where the ants actually stay. And they look, there's a name for it. So there were ants, and what they did, قَدْ حَرَّقْنَا. So Sahaba, they burned the places where there were lots of ants. The burned, قَدْ حَرَّقْنَا. فَقَالَ مَنْ حَرَّقَ هَذِهِ. Prophet said, who burned this ant? Who done this? When he saw. And he said, قُلْنَا نَحْنُ. He said, yes, we willingly. Sahaba said, willingly. قَالَ إِنَّهُ لَا يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُعَذِّبَ بِالنَّارِ إِلَّا رَبَّ النَّارِ إِلَّا رَبَّ النَّارِ. The Prophet said, no one has the authority, any permission to punish anybody in this world with fire or by fire, except the Rabb of Nar, except the creator of fire. Ajib, we're not allowed to punish anyone with the fire, not even by a creation of Allah. So we have to be very careful, even with the world of animals, creatures, and also other beings apart from or beside human beings. So if Prophet ﷺ was like that with the world of animals, birds, and insects, how he was with the human beings, you can easily imagine and easily understand. I think today we are very greatly in need of the teaching of Prophet. But again, we have a problem that we understand the teaching of Rasulullah, but we don't want to pass it over. We don't want to pass it over. Meaning we became too lazy and we don't do that. We don't spread the teaching of Prophet, neither amongst the Muslims nor amongst the non-Muslims. I believe that it is far, it is absolutely important in this country to get involved in some sort of dawah. You cannot get away, you know, you cannot escape from the punishment and from the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you are not involved in some ways of dawah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, of course we learn, we teach ourselves, we help ourselves through different means, but at the same time, we have to also get involved in spreading the message of Islam to others, to the wider community. What did Prophet ﷺ say in Hijjat al-Wida? In his last speech, what did he say? He said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. He said, you know, some of the Muslims will come and say, I'm not a scholar, so I can't be a da'i, I can't be a preacher. So I'm not a scholar, I'm not an imam, I'm not a sheikh. So they will come and give some excuses to say that I can't do da'wah. So Prophet ﷺ said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Spread on behalf of me, even if you know one thing. Even if you know one thing, and that could be Malayna and Muhammad Rasulullah. If you just know there is not worthy of worship except on, spread that, pass it on. And one of the great scholars in Islam said, even if you don't know anything, talk about the hygiene of Muslims. Muslims are the most hygienic people. Talk about the cleanliness of Muslims. At least say something. And if you don't know anything, then get lost. Because if you don't know anything of myself, there's no point in being a Muslim. So if you don't know anything, then get lost. But if you know something, then go out and spread the message of Islam. So I think that it's very important that we take this inspiration from our Prophet Muhammad. He was a man of da'wah, he was a man of everything that you can imagine, but da'wah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a mission. And anybody who is involved in da'wah, he is in the mission of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no doubt any whatsoever. And this was the mission of every messenger alayhi wa sallam. People of other faith who actually are in the wrong direction, wrong path, according to the faith and creed, but still they're busy, occupied, spreading their missionary work, and they're making people the Christians in the Muslim world. They're busy doing the aid work, and through the charity and aid work, they convert many, many Muslims to Christianity and other religions. We may not know these things, but actually they use many different other forms to convert people from Muslims to the other route to Christianity. And they use mainly the charity and aid work. So we have to be very careful. As we're Muslims, we're on the right line, and we are still at dead sleep. But people are on the wrong line, awake, and doing the jobs and working very hard to convert people. But we have to really work hard again to do our jobs, otherwise we will not be able to come out of the difficulties that we're in at the moment. And one of the reasons, of course there are many reasons for Muslims to go through whatever they're going through at this moment, one of the most difficult times for Muslims. And one of the main reasons is that because we do not do the job of Dawah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't invite people to the well of Allah. So my conclusion, I would like to request every one of us, inshallah, to get involved in some sort of Dawah, because Prophet ﷺ is the messenger, which means the Rasul, messenger, who passed the message onto others. If he didn't pass it, then we wouldn't be Muslims today here, worshipping in the same masjid, wouldn't be Muslim today. Jazakallah khairan, shukran for listening attentively.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh, for the lecture on the Prophet. So yeah, and just to let you know that we hold these talks, these events every month, so inshallah, please
do keep that in your diaries. If you want to get notified when it is and where it is, and the topics, leave your email behind with the brothers on the board. So leave your email down and we'll take it to each other. So we'll end up with our
Also, to run our activities, we obviously have some expenditures, not really fundraising, but we have a small donation box in the refreshments hall. So please, if you can participate, whatever, for towards our expenditures of these events. It's every month we do. First Sunday of every month. I don't think there is any regular monthly events probably in Tahamas. Alhamdulillah, we're trying our best to uphold and keep it continuous every month. In every circumstance we're trying to do, obviously that needs some expenditure. So if you can, inshallah, that will be. And fruits upstairs, inshallah, after the dua, is making way to the refreshments hall, whatever we could manage, we'll inshallah provide something. Please enjoy your food before you leave. And make dua for us as well. Jazakumullah khairan. Also, Jazakumullah khairan to Bani Islam Masjid, management, the chairman, and his team for facilitating us in this masjid. Jazakumullah khairan. ربنا اتقبل منا انك انت التواب انك انت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا انك انت التواب الرحيم اللهم اكسب عن افرس والله اكسب this humble effort والله grant us all the goodness in this world and in the next world والله you've sent us you've created us you've sent us to this world you gave us everything that we needed but we always were ungrateful and disobedient servants of you we're repenting to you tonight to forgive our sins Increase your love and love all the prophets in our hearts. O Allah, grant us the beneficial knowledge. O Allah, put us amongst the ulama al-Bayyin, the divine scholars. O Allah, put us amongst the preachers who act upon what they say, what they preach. O Allah, accept the efforts of Al-Fatihah and the Ulifah. So all the Muslim organizations, in whatever forms they are spreading the words of Islam, accept the efforts and grant every one of us the sincerity. O Allah, help us and help the Muslims all over the world. Muslims are suffering tremendously across the world. Well, help them and raise the status of Islam and Muslims. Grant us the ability to unite us amongst ourselves. Allah, unite the hearts of this Ummah, this Muslim Ummah. Help us all over the world. Allah, free all the occupied lands. Grant the shifa and remedy to all the people who are unwell. And also bestow your mercy upon the graves of all diseased people. And especially our parents, رب ارحمهما كما ربيانا صغارا رب ارحمهما كما ربيانا صغارا صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين